here to this month's games now. Good to see you here. And I'm Perttu Hämäläinen. I'm acting as an emergency replacement here for Joonas Laakso, who unfortunately couldn't come as planned. But fortunately, I'm not alone. We have two other speakers, Markus Montola, Jaakko Lehtinen. And today we are going to first have brief presentations each, and then questions and discussion. The theme is loosely research and impact in the industry or also in society. So we are talking about our research and how that connects to industry. All of us have both university and industry background. I think the speakers will introduce themselves when it's their turn as well. And I'll go first myself. And just as a note, so today's speakers, we are both from Aalto and University of Tampere, which both have game research tradition. And I must also advertise that soon Aalto's game design and production master studies application process is starting. So if you want to get a master degree in game design, please apply. But yeah, I'll start with our game research group showreel. If it starts. Okay. Demo effect. It did work. Maybe I'll restart PowerPoint.
You should use Keynote.
Yeah. This is a new PC. I've never presented on this before, but I tested it. It worked. Let's see. Again. Well. Crap. You should see this screen. It's beyond comprehension. Okay. Let's skip that video and see if the rest works. Okay, I'm going to talk both about societal and industry impacts. And okay. Sorry about this. I have to switch display configuration. Let's have this duplicated because clearly the extension does not work. If I can't fix this, then I'll just skip and we'll have Jaakko and Markus. Okay. Let's see. It plays there. Will it play full screen? That's the question. No.
Play it small.
Yes, we do that. I yield. Jaakko, please step in.
Okay, maybe you can create a version without videos to
yeah, but
while I
let's see, there's not much point because
I have lots of videos, so we'll see what happens to me, right?
But you have a Mac.
Yes, but some of my slides are out of necessity. PowerPoint on Mac, which is even worse than okay. PowerPoint on Windows. So we'll see. Anyway. Well, I'm sure most of you know Perttu's work already. Anyway, My name is Jaakko Lehtinen. I'm an associate professor at the computer science department at the School of Science at Aalto. I concentrate on the technical aspects of computer graphics, that is to say, the technology on how you actually draw and animate the stuff you see on the screen in games. So it's not content generation, it's the algorithms behind the content that sort of make the final experience run on screen and so forth. I'm also, actually this title is out of date, I'm a principal research scientist with NVIDIA Research as well. So I share my time with an industrial research lab as well. And I'm going to share with you two examples of machine learning research in graphics and how how it can change content production. My own background is I started out as a hobbyist. I worked straight out of high school. I worked at Remedy. I created the tools that were used for modeling and scripting and texturing and in particular lighting the games Max Payne 1 and 2 that Remedy released in 2001 and 3, and we were the first ones in the world to have a proper physically based illumination model in the games, and that's mostly what I worked on there. But so, in order to draw nice looking pictures, we need geometry. Someone needs to model our scene. We need to put some lights in because pictures would be black if we had no light, because pictures are formed by interaction of light and matter. Then, in order to make our scenes look interesting, we need materials for our scenes. And then, you know, once we've done all of this, we've created our geometry, we've created our materials, and put some lights in, then it's the job of the renderer or rendering algorithm to take all of these descriptions and turn it into a picture, right? And when we do this for real, we solve integral equations or integral differential equations that describe the propagation of radiation in a medium. This is not going to be a math-heavy problem. I'm just saying that physically based illumination means solving equations that look like that. But then, when you create content, someone really has to go in and model the tiniest detail of the geometry and movement. And okay, you're not seeing a whole lot in this lighting, but it's a shot from the first Hobbit movie, just to illustrate the fact that the complexity behind a modern, say, film scene is really quite immense. I'm going to talk about two recent case studies in content generation or capture from real world. That is to say, capturing material appearance models from real surfaces. And doing facial performance capture, both of these using deep learning. So the first material capture project is something that we've done in collaboration. This is mostly my graduate student Mika Aittola's work. It's published in the SIGGRAPH Technical Papers Program this year. It's collaboration with NVIDIA Research. The fancy looking title means how to use your cell phone to capture photorealistic surface appearance models that you can drop in into your game. Well, this is just an illustration that materials do make a big difference in content. Our robot friend here would not be overly interesting if it did not have interesting colors and shininesses and so forth. But surface appearance is really not just about texture. You know, your first idea is to take a picture of a surface and then slap it on a mesh and be done with it. However, you miss all the interesting detail regarding how highlights shift on the on interesting surfaces. You miss all the details about the bumps and grooves and variations that actually are essential for bringing lots of surfaces around us to life. It's not just really a picture. It's much more than that. And one thing that's interesting is that if you look around you, most materials here, if you look closely enough, they are textured in the sense that there's something, you know, they're either homogeneous or there's something that repeats over that surface. You know, cloth has, you know, some semi-structured random repetitions. Stone has similar things. But on, you know, when you look at it on a large enough scale, things often look somewhat homogeneous. And this is something that we're going to exploit to capture appearance. Here's a photo of a leather sofa. And really, again, you know, take any object in here. If you look at it closely enough, you often come up with, you know, some material. At some scale, you end up with a material that's homogeneous, and we call these materials textured. What it means is that even, you know, no matter We can pick out any position or patch of material, and regardless of which exact patch we look like, you know, it roughly looks the same everywhere, right? And so this means that in particular, we can take a small tile of this material, and then we can use standard algorithms for creating basically infinite amounts of variations of the same material by just, you know, basically copying stuff and rearranging this small exemplar in various ways. And this is something that's been done for ages. However, if we light this object in interesting ways, it becomes clear that this single picture is not going to be enough to capture this appearance. And so in graphics, we often model interesting surface reflectance as a combination of diffuse base color and specular reflection on top of that. It's really the appearance is given rise by, if we look at a small incident beam of light, shape of the reflected beam after it's interacted with the surface is the thing that really determines appearance. So for instance, a perfect mirror is a surface that reflects everything exactly to the same direction, right? And we use various kinds of models called BRDFs to represent these surfaces. And there are many, many parametric models that we can use. Now things get really interesting if we start making these reflectance parameters like the diffuse colors and shininesses and local surface normals vary over our surface. That is to say, we let the base color change, we let the color of specular or shiny reflection change over the surface. How sharp the reflection is over the surface, we let that change, and we let the local surface normal change to capture small, tiny bumps in there. And in some of our recent results, we've shown that if you capture these kinds of appearance maps carefully, you can yield, for many surfaces, reproductions of appearance that you can't tell from a photograph. So here we're seeing a photograph of an actual surface lit by an area light source on the left, and our rendering, virtual reproduction of that same thing on the right. And the thing to note here is that the thing we're drawing on the right, it has really two triangles and then spatially varying reflectance model on top of that. So it's really it's these kinds of maps and a standard shader that you see in any game today, and the geometry is really just these two things. So what I'm hoping to convey here is that there's a lot of quality on the table. However, even today, game asset pipelines often, you know, even if they use reflectance models like this, there are no really universally accepted ways of producing content for these models that would lead to reproductions like that. So people use lots of different kinds of heuristics like Crazy Bump and various kinds of image processing tools to try and somehow hack their way from photographs into these maps. And that just doesn't work. It's tedious, and the results you get are mediocre at best. So capturing stuff from the real world is what's required in order to get results like that. However, you don't want to use capture devices that are large and heavy. And in this work, we're actually just going around with a regular cell phone, a stock cell phone, and hoping to do this with a single picture. And so what makes us hope we can do this is that if you think about a photo of a textured material that's taken with a flash, with a cell phone flash, we see various patches of this material that have been lit from different directions. Like, so this is lit from the upper left, this is lit from the front, and so forth. And this variation in lighting directions is what we need in order to actually fit a reflectance model to this data. And so our aim is to take a picture like this and then sort of squeeze it down into a small tile of spatially varying reflectance parameters that then reproduces the appearance. So I'm just going to skip this and go straight into basically how it works. So here's an input photo of a material. Our unknown is this small tile of reflectance parameters. And when our solution is correct, once we've found the proper maps, it has the property that when I place this tile of parameters anywhere on the screen and I render it in the lighting conditions that we see at this particular point in the image, the result should blend in with whatever I see in this flash photo, right? And if, again, if the result is correct, I could pick, you know, some parameters there and get a really perfect reproduction in the center. But then when I move it away from there, things would, you know, unless we're being careful, things will break. But once our solution is really correct, then I can start sliding this tile of material around in this input photo, and whenever, you know, whenever I render it from the same illumination direction, I should get something that matches well, right? And how we do this is we really cast this as an optimization problem. So our unknown is a set of material parameters, and for some number of tiles in this input picture, we say whenever I render the unknown solution from that particular direction, that's what I call R, the results should look like whatever the tile that I picked from the original photo. And when I do the same thing for, you know, a number of different tiles in the picture, yet again, the material model, the unknown is the same everywhere. We're just sort of lighting the unknown model from various directions and saying that we want it to look the same than the underlying thing. Now, there's one problem with that, is that our unknown tile of material, it has a certain fixed structure, whereas the image tiles that we see below, you know, it's maybe a stochastic material. It's, you know, it's not, there's no pixel-to-pixel correspondence, and there's no way to actually drive this optimizer. So here's something to illustrate. On the top, I have a single tile of reflectance parameters that I've rendered in various configurations. Here are corresponding tiles from the input photo. They look kind of the same, right? I mean, it's a reasonable fit to the appearance. However, if I pick two rendering tile from input photo and I compare them pixel to pixel, I notice that they're very different. Like, this is not something, I can't demand that the renderings should match pixel to pixel. This is not going to give me a proper solution. This is where we use deep convolutional networks to come up with a texture image distance metric that has the really intriguing and quite non-trivial property that whenever we show it two examples of the same texture, even if they would be, you know, different pixel to pixel, our metric is going to say, okay, these are the same thing. And then we're going to use this distance metric to drive an optimizer that finds reflectance parameters that match the proper thing. I should probably go really a lot faster and skip and just basically. So that's the magic. We need a function that's if you're into math, that needs to be differentiable, and that says, you know, how do I need to change this one picture so that it becomes more like the other picture, but without regard for the exact arrangement of pixels. And that's what the deep learning metric is using. And so actually, I'll skip this as well. And just mention that we based this metric on a really cool paper that was published at NIPS last year, which is using deep convolutional networks for texture synthesis. It doesn't do reflectance, it just does texture. But it's based on running an exemplar image through a convolutional network that was trained for classifying images, then extracting some sort of statistical descriptors of the intermediate hidden layers within that network, then turning things around, starting from a random noise input and asking, how do you have to change the pixels in this input, such that when you run it through the network and extract the statistics, they match whatever you got from the original. I'm not expecting you to follow exactly what's going on here, but it's the basis. If you saw, for instance, summer last year, this was all the rage, this neural style transfer stuff, where you take a photo, or you take a picture, you take a style image, like, for instance, the Munch painting, and then you can sort of turn your picture into the style of the other. This is an application of the same kind of texture-aware distance metrics that we were using here. So we're driving an optimizer with a metric that responds to similar texture without caring for the exact layout of pixels. So what we really do, our algorithm is, we pick these a number of different tiles from the input image. We have our unknown reflectance map. We say, okay, I render this reflectance map from these different lighting directions. I have the corresponding target tiles that I want the appearance to match. Then we just compare these pairs of rendered versus real images in terms of this neural descriptor, which is differentiable. We can drive an optimization loop that iteratively changes these things so that the matches between the renderings and the real thing become better and better. Okay. And so here's what it looks like in the course of the optimization. We start with a poor initial guess, but then as the optimization progresses, we see that it finds the values, like how exactly do I need to bump the surface to get the proper appearance for the highlights? Like, how do I have to change the color at every point and the shininess and glossiness at every point such that the renderings actually start to match what we see in there? And now, the cool thing is that even though we started with just a single picture of taken with a flash, the static pictures taken with a flash of a material, now what we can do is we can, all of a sudden, we're in possession of a reflectance model that we can use for relighting and covering, you know, any virtual object with this material and get nice looking reproductions of that appearance. Someone who's not in graphics pointed out to me that this is very underwhelming. Like, why are you not showing it on top of some 3D object? But I'd never thought of it before. That, I mean, as someone who knows how content is made for games, it's trivial for you and I to understand that, you know, you can obviously wrap this on any object you want, but it's not necessarily obvious to someone else. But so this is an unprecedented result. It's not been possible before in the world to get surface appearance reproductions that you can get with such little data, just, you know, a single image taken with a stock cell phone. And so we feel that is pretty cool. Here's another example of how an optimizer finds the reflectance parameters that explain the appearance of this painted metal surface, and a similar rendering of that same surface before. We have lots of these examples, and I'm going to skip tons and tons of detail. I did want to briefly touch. So this is one thing. This is research. This research and our algorithm from last year, which is based on two pictures, which works in a very different way, these are currently being productized by NVIDIA under a non-exclusive license from Aalto. So we are hopefully going to see content generation products that feature this exact technology in the near future. Another thing I want to mention is a joint project we did at Remedy, at NVIDIA, in collaboration with Remedy Entertainment on capturing facial performances for story-driven games. If you've seen Quantum Break, you know they have lots and lots of famous actors and lots of dialogue and an hour's worth of facial animation in the game. And how they produce that is they have this 9-camera video camera set up in their basement where they shine bright lights in the faces of their actors, ask them to stand very still, and then, you know, play out their lines. Then what happens is they take these video streams, they run computer vision on these to basically do 3D reconstructions of each one of these individual frames, and then after that, software takes a mesh that's, you know, a high quality mesh. And deforms it frame by frame to match the geometry of the face of the actor at that particular frame, right? And so it's a long pipeline involving classical multi-view stereo 3D reconstruction and so on. It's also optical flows in there, and you have to fix errors by hand after the fact. It's not fully automated. So what we wanted to do here is to see whether or not we can teach a convolutional neural network to basically do all of the hard part without any of this classical vision stuff, just from a single video frame. And so the point is that if we run the heavy classical process on a small subset of the content, say 5 minutes, produce the, you know, run the heavy pipeline on a tiny subset of the content, maybe we can then teach a convolutional network to say, when you see this input frame, produce this geometry for the mesh. And that's exactly what we did. And of course, if you really need just 5 minutes of footage to teach a network that generalizes well, then you're going to save a lot of money because you can just produce a lot more animation in the same amount of time. So I'll skip all of that and just show you some results. So here on the lower left, you see the result in a validation shot. You see the result of the classical pipeline involving vision and manual corrections and so forth. And on the lower right, you see a result produced by our convolutional neural network only from that single input video frame. It's not seeing the 9 video frames. It's just seeing that single thing. And it has not seen this particular clip during training. So it is a generalization, right? And you know, you can see that the match is it's pretty good. I mean, you'll be hard pressed to find a difference like just looking at it like this. There are some differences. Sometimes you get slight over smoothing in some regions. At other times, it actually fixes problems of the input data for you. And it is so good that we've concluded that a single camera is enough, and it is actually good enough for production. It is being used in Remedy's current production right now. They estimate that it would have saved them 90% of the time they used for generating the facial animation for Quantum Break, and so it's a great success for our joint project. I won't talk about the network architecture or anything like that, and leave time for the next speaker. Thank you.
I think you can hear. Now you can hear me. Okay. Perttu asked me to say that. Asked me to remind you to remember your questions, and then you can ask them after my talk when we have a panel session over there. Yes, everything seems to be looking nice. Hello, everyone. My name is Markus Montola. I currently work at Reforge Studios, a Helsinki startup. We're making mobile games, free-to-play stuff. But my history is as a game scholar. I used to be a game scholar at University of Tampere. Then I moved on to Nokia Research Center, made my PhD in location-based and pervasive games in 2010, and then joined the mobile boom, the startup boom in Helsinki. And at the moment, I'm in my fourth company, I think, over the course of 5 years or something. So I've been doing a lot of research, and I've been doing a lot of design. And this talk is all about one case example of where I studied some stuff, and a lot of other people also studied that stuff for, I don't know, 7 years, 8 years. And then we saw something happen in the market, and we found that, you know, these things we observed and those things we didn't observe, and how this tells one story about how design and scholarship can interact. I first encountered a location-based augmented reality game on mobile phones in 2003. This game was called Songs of North. It was made in University of Tampere. I wasn't participating in that project, but I was participating in many projects that followed from this one. The idea in Songs of North was that you took a phone, you took a map, and then you run around the city of Tampere with your phone interacting with things that you could only sense because you were using the device. So basically, your typical, nowadays typical case of augmented reality street play. It was played on Nokia N-Gage phone. I don't know who of you have actually seen this device in the real world. It was a fascinating device. You obviously didn't have a touchscreen. You barely had a screen. You barely had audio. And all the buttons you were using to play the games were sort of rubbery, and the interactions were pretty hard. And the team led by, I think, Petra Lankoski and Franz Maurer, they actually managed to pull off an augmented reality map-based game on this device, and I think that's quite a feat. Of course, when I say augmented reality, they didn't... I'm not sure if N-Gage had a camera, but I'm betting that it didn't. I'm pretty sure it didn't. So they couldn't augment basic reality, so they could only augment sound. So how they pulled off their entire game is that you have this drum here, this shaman drum, and you're using the shaman drum with the keyboard buttons to drum different rhythms and tones so that the spirits can answer. And when you encounter a fox spirit, then the little beeper in the phone starts making phone sounds. And it was recommended that you play it with earplugs because the quality of sound in those would be far better. I think they tested it with something like 20 players, 25 players, for a couple of weeks, maybe a month. They filled manually, they filled the maps of Tampere with stuff, so when you went to the, I don't know, the church area, there would be something relevant to the church area, and when you went into a park, there would be forest spirits in the park. And this was all really nice, and they came up with quite a lot of interesting results from that project. My life personally was changed by this project because as a conclusion of this project, they managed to join a large-scale EU project that ran for 4 years in four different European countries where we studied pervasive games. Pervasive games, we figured out, mean games that blur the boundary of reality and a game. So for instance, in games of Songs of North, the way the blurring happens is that I'm walking on the real street because I'm chasing a virtual fox spirit or something. The games we created in iPerg project, we had a lot of different prototypes. We created everything from LARPs that you would play on streets that would interact with random passersby to quite a bit of augmented reality games. For instance, here is one of our smallest prototypes, a game called Insectopia. In Insectopia, you take your phone, again, without a proper screen and without proper internet and without proper anything. And you would go around the streets chasing Wi-Fi signals. And whenever we found a Wi-Fi SSID, we would decide that, you know, it's a Goliath beetle because we calculated some hash from the SSID. And over the course of your days, you would go into the same bus maybe every time. You would pick whatever flies and things there would be in the bus, and then you would go to the work and so forth. And maybe you would even encounter the same animals over and over and again. You get a bonus if you find the same animal again. And then we had these players doing all kinds of location-based stuff that always happens if you have a curated environment, then you can predict what happens with the environment. When you have an uncurated environment of Insectopia, where every Wi-Fi is an insect, what do? It's year 2005, I think. Wi-Fi is not as common as it's today. It's common, but not that common. So then you go to the airport, and then in the airport you find that there are lots of people with fancy devices on, and then you get all the insects. And people would do this kind of things in our experiment. And it was super interesting. We even wrote a book on the findings of the iPerg project, and it was all really nice. Here's another game we did at Nokia, or actually they did at Nokia for the iPerg project. This was called Mythical: The Mobile Awakening. And in Mythical, you would play a wizard in the modern world. You would collect mana you would fight again random monsters, you would complete quests, and you even had a fancy magical system based on geometry where different players in different locations could collaborate in casting rituals based on their geographical locations. And here is Epidemic Menace, our project did in Germany. Your campus is full of viruses. The viruses are invisible. So the only ways to find the viruses are different scanners and visors. They used a combination from everything from tablets to augmented reality glasses to everything, so that you would have different roles for different people in the pandemic fashion to clean the area from the viruses. Someone would be at the command center and see the map while someone else would be chasing the actual viruses. In this game, they even did stuff with weather. So if you had an airborne virus, it would go in the direction of the wind because they knew where the wind was blowing. If it was warm, some bacteria would be more prevalent, and if it was dry, some other bacteria would be more prevalent. So they did a lot of interesting experimentation, and of course the 3D models were a little bit simplistic at times. I think this is a artist's vision on how the game looked, because we couldn't take screenshots on those devices, but it was pretty nice. We learned a lot of stuff about, you know, the AR glasses, especially the AR glasses of 2006. They were clunky. They are not fun to have in your head while you're running on the streets. And when it's very bright, the sun is shining very bright, it's very hard to see any viruses on the screen. A lot of stuff that's sort of important but quite basic once you actually have the Google Glass or whatever in your head and you're experimenting. Then App Store happened, and Apple brought out the iPhone, and combined with Google Maps, like everybody could make a location-based game. This is only some of the games that happened in 2011, I think. There were way more. One of the common factors of these games was that you get to use Google Maps in your game if you don't change the visual outlook of the Google Maps. And then you had a lot of games that looked like Google Maps, and they were not fun to play at all. A lot of interesting experiments, and I think two experiments or two commercial projects in that genre were probably more popular than the others. The one on the left is Shadow Cities, and the one on the right is Ingress. Shadow Cities was the game I was involved in, and I'll just show a video of, I'll just take a personal risk of working with technology here to show a video of Shadow Cities to you. I hope we even have some audio, maybe.
Hundreds of years ago, an ancient, now long forgotten form.
This is going to be interesting.
Hundreds of years ago, an ancient, now long forgotten force pulsed through our world. This alternative reality has now returned, using technology as the gateway. It will challenge you. It will disrupt your concept of what is real and what is not. Join us. Forge alliances. Secure your territory and fight back. Our battleground is where we live. Our streets. Our cities. Choose a side. Defend your area, gain control of your city, and expand your influence across continents. Shadow Cities, it's a game.
It's real.
So that was Shadow Cities. You can imagine when I was working on games like this for 5 years something, 6 years, and we were completely in the kind of technological utopia where we used these VR glasses, and we wanted to have one more player, but it was too expensive because the glasses were so expensive. One day I read from Helsingin Sanomat that some guys who were living on the same street I was living in Helsinki were building something like that. So I immediately, of course, contacted them and ended up a game designer for them. And it was interesting working on Shadow Cities when I had all that experience and background from the research community. I had probably seen more location-based games than many other people on the planet. And then you're faced with an actual design challenge of how to make this and this screen look nice, and how to actually get your mother to understand what's happening on this screen. And they were quite different challenges compared to the challenges we were fighting against with the experimental games. Because with experimental games, your challenges are like, can we make the Wi-Fi actually identify insects? Whereas in here, the question was more in like, is the green enough or should it be green? Like, they're quite different challenges. Shadow Cities, I think it went pretty well. It secured the funding for our company, but it didn't take off in a big way. A couple of years later, Google's Ingress, nowadays Niantic's Ingress, came out. It also wasn't a great success, but it was successful enough to make Niantic go along for quite a while and for them to learn some things about design. And then, of course, everyone knows Pokemon Go came out from Niantic. And I think they have about 500 million downloads at the moment. Apparently, there are about 2 billion smartphones on the planet. So I think they've reached a quarter of their potential audience. I'm under the impression that they have lost a couple of 100 million players, but they're still doing really, really, really well. So when people are saying Pokemon Go is dead, I think what they're saying, they lost a couple of 100 million players, but they are wrong because it's far from dead, and I think we'll be seeing Pokemon Go everywhere for the next, I don't know, decade or something. I didn't even bother to put any screenshots from Pokemon Go because everyone knows it. Who has played Pokemon Go in here? You should try it. All right, so this is the interesting part. What did we get right? I studied pervasive games, location-based games. I saw about 10 prototypes of our own project, and I saw probably dozens of prototypes by other people during those years. And what did we get right? So I looked at my old presentations, and I looked at the pervasive games book we did at 2009, and I just looked at some central learnings. These learnings do not include the learnings of Shadow Cities, because Shadow Cities was design work. And I'm looking, what did we understand when we did research? First of all, your city is a game. That's a really fun principle that the guys who were working at Shadow Cities before I joined the project had also discovered pretty much independently. But it is fun to have your city be as a game, because then everything in your city changes its meaning. Like, you go into the park and it's no longer Ruttapuisto, it's now the park with the lure parties. On the other hand, your game is a flash mob. We never saw this in any of our games, but we were fully aware that this will happen once these games make it big. We were fully aware and a little bit concerned what happens in New York Central Park when someone puts a rare Pokemon in there. When we worked on Shadow Cities, we actually were talking about like how we'd like to get the Pokemon license, but of course it was madness for us to even dream of such things. We understood that screens and traffic mean danger. That's something that happens in AR research all the time. It's probably in half of the papers. And whenever we staged actual prototype studies with visors and everything, we had some situations which, like, when we were doing participatory observation, we saw someone doing something really stupid with the devices, and it always became part of our research notes. We understood ludic socialization. We understood that games bring people together, and they give them something common to talk about, and then surprising people start talking with each other. It's like walking a dog on the street and people start talking to you because they talk about your dog. It's something like that, but now with actual game content. We understood that you don't know your own city, and you would actually like to do some sightseeing in your own city. And the places people have learned playing games like Pokemon Go, so many places, so many people go in weird places in Suomenlinna where they haven't gone before because there's Pikachu in somewhere in there. And conversely, games create tourist attractions. People go into places just because there is this game. We understood that attractions don't want to be playful. Especially, I think the German concentration camps have been quite upset about the fact that people are hunting Pokemon in there. And this is something we already got in our prototypes. We had a tiny LARP, and some event in the tiny LARP was supposed to happen at the graveyard. And pretty quickly after the LARP had started, we understood that this might not have been the best idea. We understood that critical mass is a critical problem. You make a game for 6 billion people, but the problem is, especially in Shadow City, as it turned out later on, it's extremely difficult to make sure that everywhere where people pick up the game and play their first session, there is someone else to play with. It's a really maddening, because when we worked Shadow Cities later, we worked in Helsinki, so it was perfectly balanced for Helsinki. Whenever you logged in, you could see one or two players, which was nice, unless you tried it on Manhattan, and then it was a nightmare, because there were so many people. And we lost so many people in I don't know, Montana, whatever, where someone logged in and saw, there's a street, I live on the street, and then it's black. We understood that time and space both matter. It's fun to make players go somewhere really early in the morning, because otherwise they don't. It's like sightseeing in your own game to go catch a Pikachu at, I don't know, 5 a.m. in the morning. I'm really looking forward to the point where Pokemon starts really doing that. We realized the social expansion dimension of the game. We understood that when you have this kind of a game, the game starts to interact with the outsiders, and the outsiders start to interact with the game. So what happens in Helsinki is that ice cream vendors are placing lures in Ruttapuisto and other places so that they can attract first Pokemon and then the Pokemon players. This is actually something that happened when I talked with ice cream vendors, which was nice. One funny thing is players start to see players everywhere. Everyone who plays Pokemon thinks that those kids are also playing Pokemon. And it's funny because many of them are, but not all of them are. And when you actually go and see their screens, they're not playing Pokemon, they're doing something else. But you feel that everyone is playing it. It's a nice feeling. Ultimately, the game will merge with your real life. You start thinking of, I could go to school this way or that way, and there is Pikachu, so I'll go that way. And you start thinking that way. These are just some examples of things that we sort of foresaw before Pokemon happened. And it's been super nice to see Pokemon people getting all excited in Facebook about these things, because I predict that this will give me a lot of citations when they read my book, when they try to publish about this stuff, because we've said it about Songs of North or something before. So that's fun. But the downside, what did we not see? Like, things we should have seen, maybe. Things that, like, and while these are nice, this is, of course, a $1 billion question in quite literal sense, because I'm still not a billionaire. And if we had seen all this, it might be different. First thing is that a maddeningly casual game can break a staggeringly hardcore genre. Whenever we worked on anything, people had really hard time understanding that, you know, I take my phone and then I actually walk and then something happens. A year ago, it was really hard for people to understand, and especially when we worked before iPhone broke out. It was crazy hard to understand for people. And we were thinking in many points, like, you have to start from hardcore audiences because they are willing to be invested, they care about the technology, they want to get into it, and they will be the target audience. And we were so wrong, because the game that actually broke is like, you take a ball and you toss it, and you know, they cheat half of the tossing, and, you know, okay, whatever. So the game that actually broke into this extremely hard genre was the game grandmothers can play with their grandkids. And that is, I think, pretty impressive. Moving around is gameplay in itself. We were stacking gameplay features. We were figuring how to make this gameplay interesting. And then in the fashion of making super casual game, they just said, like, you go somewhere and then you pick up the game and that's the gameplay. You can fight in Pokemon Go, but have you fought? Who here has played Pokemon Go and really doesn't like the fighting? Right. Is there someone who plays Pokemon Go and really likes the fighting? One. OK. Yeah, we had a lot of fighting in our games. Lots and lots of fighting. Important lesson, go big or go home. The way to solve the critical mass is to be so massive that you have it. And when you have the critical mass, then newspapers start writing about you, and then you start to generate the ecosystem where ice cream vendor guys are making placing lures to attract you, and then everyone is in the game, and then you have the entire ludic society happen, and it all comes true. And we understood that critical mass is a critical problem. I just said it, but we couldn't, like, we never understood that going massive will be the solution. Of course, going massive requires you to have, I don't know, a couple of dozens of millions to do something like this, and you have to convince some Pokemon execs to do this. But it was something we couldn't find out. We just knew that it was a problem. This is very interesting. Restrict social behavior cleverly to make it work. When I picked up the Pokemon the first time, on the first day when it came out, I think a couple of hours after it came out, I was so insanely surprised that they had no social feature whatsoever. It doesn't have a chat, you can't see other players, you can't trade, you can't, like, their only social mechanic is fighting in the gyms that you, and even that you can't access if you're an early player. And this is, of course, ingenious, because how they make social interaction happen is that you have to talk to other people. In Shadow Cities, you were chatting in the same corner, two players, like, are you fighting those mages? Yes, I'm fighting those mages. But Pokemon Go just cut that off and made people actually interact, which is nice. I mean, if you go big, then it's nice, because then there's someone you can talk to. If you're not big, then, oh. Loser spatial configuration helps with critical mass. Even in Shadow Cities, we were trying to map the Earth ourselves. We were placing objectives into the maps. Not as clearly as in Songs of North, where every spirit was manually placed in somewhere. But we were still deciding the exact spots people could fight over. And we were plotting them on map software in our office. We actually hired some summer workers to plot things into, I don't know, Barcelona or something, because we wanted our game to be playable in Barcelona. And it was a crazy amount of work. And the problem was that we create such a rigid spatial configuration, it was hard to scale the game anywhere. But Pokemon, that barely looks at those things, like, their algorithms are pretty abstract. It's playable everywhere, which is quite nice. IP is extremely powerful in teaching people new things. Interaction distance of 10 meters beats interaction distance of 100 meters. In Pokemon, when you have something somewhere, people actually have to walk next to it and then start playing with it. So then when you're observing it, you can see they just walked in here next to the, I don't know, next to that statue and started doing things. Whereas in Shadow Cities, our interaction distance was a couple of hundred meters. We were thinking of our games like, I'm the mage who is controlling this city block. You're the mage who is controlling the next city block, and then we're fighting, like, over the streets and, you know, through the blocks. And it was perfect for us because we never had that kind of critical mass. We could never, like, if your mages have to fight at 10 meter distance, the fights will never happen. But at the same time, that was a little bit of a dead end design because we never could make the players interact for real. Also, if you had a neighborhood bully in your neighborhood, whenever you logged in, he would be there and he would kick your ass, and that wasn't very fun. Flimsy augmented reality still generates value because people want their photos to be good. If you've tried Pokemon, you can see that whenever you turn your camera, the Pokemon floats in weird places. And actually, it's trivially easy to lose your Pokemon or take a horrible picture of the Pokemon with your camera. But the funny thing is that people are actually, they're putting quite a bit of effort in making sure the Pokemon is sitting nicely on the table when I take the shot. And then I share the shot in the internet, and then you think the AR is actually pretty good. And then you take the game and you figure out the AR is actually pretty sucky, but it's sort of funny. And then I take a funny picture and I share it too. So I think Pokemon is not very good at augmented reality in technical sense, but they are making an extremely good marketing device out of the fact that they are selling you the dream that this game is overlapping with the reality. At our research projects, we were lamenting over the fact that our AR was totally crappy because it was 2006 AR and it was horrible. And it turns out it never needed to be great anyway, especially if it has no game value like it doesn't in Pokemon. And finally, we didn't understand that lure parties monetize. Who has been to a lure party? Okay, lure party is when someone is sitting in a bar with a Pokestop there, and places to lure there so Pokemons come there. And then we can all casually talk and drink beer and catch some Pokemons. And 15 minutes later or whatever, the lure goes away and then the next guy puts a lure. I don't remember precisely how much lure cost, but eventually when you have 10 people doing this and it's sort of your turn to get a lure for a euro or whatever, you have to do it. And that's how you socially monetize in a nice way. Of course, our prototypes did have no monetization in, so we had no idea how it works. So I sort of have two slides here. One about what did we get right, and another about what did we not see. I usually don't put this much text on the slide, but I wanted to show all this on the one slide, so I put everything on two tight slides, and I'm sorry about that. But when you look at those two slides, there's something nasty about them. Because the truth is, this stuff we learned, it's not so great game design advice. Especially if you're trying to run a business, it's not very interesting for you to know that screens plus traffic means danger. I mean, it's critically valuable for us as a society to understand it. But when you're trying to make your game work, it's not your first and foremost concern. Your concern is this blue enough? Is this button big enough? What will the player do during the first 2 minutes? Those are the questions you're trying to answer. We understood that ice cream vendors will join this game when this game is going on, and it will be great and interesting and societally quite relevant, but we had no idea how to make the game that would go and grow as far as to actually attract the ice cream vendors. I think once you attract the ice cream vendors, you have solved all your game design problems already. Whereas the stuff we missed is actually some pretty great game design advice. And I'm not saying that game scholarship isn't valuable. I think it's super valuable. But at the same time, I'm thinking that to learn about how game design works, you actually have only one way, which is to design and fail until someone succeeds, and then everyone knows that works. It's part of, like, when you're a scholar and you try to understand how things work, you get observations about how it would work if it worked. But you don't need to face the fact, you don't need to face the product market fit every day. If I created this game and if I built this kind of a tutorial for the game, would anyone play it? You don't need to face the fact that if anyone would play it, would they pay for it? Because you're not trying to collect money with your game. Another thing is that game design is very iterative. Of course, you take your own game and you play your own game and then it sucks and then you improve it. But it's also iterative across projects. So when I need an inventory in my game, I look at five other games and figure out how did they make an inventory. I think it was nice. And then I pick one of them, steal it to my game, adjust it a little bit, and then I'm ready. With our pervasive game research project, we didn't have any successful games that we could look up to. Like we couldn't look at Epidemic Menace that was played on one campus and then figure out, okay, this needs something from Songs of North, which worked so well. Because Songs of North had 20 players, it was played for 1 month, and no one at the Epidemic Menace team had actually played it. Also, it's not like Songs of North was successful, so we could say, let's do the same as Songs of North did, but better, so we'll be even more successful. We were sort of, because we were studying the future of games, we were sort of trying to find our way in the dark, and it was pretty dark in the dark. And I think it was very well spent time. We got a lot of observations that now we understand with Pokemon. We can actually look at the Pervasive Games book and open it on random page and say, ooh, that happened when they managed to create one of these things. And another page, and oh, that also happened. But it doesn't tell you how to make that game. And to make that, to succeed in that, you actually have to look at Pokemon and other games and figure, those things work. Now I innovate a little bit and iterate on that, and now I can make something that a little bit more reliably might work. So that's my case on the relationship of game scholarship and game design. I'm sorry it's a little bit cynical, and I think if my scholarly friends look at this video, they will give me some feedback. But with this, thank you.
Google it up. It seemed to help with some people. Let's see. One more time. Okay, worked, and thanks Jaakko and Markus for your great contributors. I'm trying to be quick and kind of add on and not repeat what you said. But so I thought of my group's research of like technological game research in general and human-computer interaction, and thought that I should try to give examples of these three categories. So we've in my group we've done all three. So research as understanding and modeling players, research as problem solving, and research as exploration and discovery. And now I'm thinking of these categories in relation to your talks, I would mostly place Jaakko's in the problem solving and maybe Markus in the exploration and discovery, but also understanding, not so much modeling players, but understanding the societal things and phenomena. So yeah, I think these are all important aspects. And first of all, I want to say that research doesn't happen without passion and motivation. So what for example, we say that all the game research works on, it depends on people, what they are interested in. I have my interest, but then the PhD students and master's thesis workers, they have theirs. And so I very much encourage people to get their own funding to work on what they are passionate about and not something that I'm saying we should research. So first case, research as understanding and modeling players. This is kind of the basic research, similar to human-computer interaction. So I'm presenting a piece of research that was the final project of Felipe Morelis Alonso, one of my students, and Felipe is now a game designer at Rovio. The main research question there was, how does virtual game camera design affect movement skills in VR? So we are now moving with our bodies in VR. Some things are hard, some are easy. But then how does the virtual camera affect that? Basically, we launched virtual balls at users that tried to catch them. And then we measured their performance. And we manipulated a single thing, the camera perspective. So we used different cameras, first person, third person, and something in between. And to give some background and motivation why we did this, let's first review the main types of cameras and what are their benefits and disadvantages. So first person camera in first person shooters, many other games, walking sims, so on. It's often claimed to yield the most immersive and natural experience. On the other hand, a third-person camera, or 3PP, can give the user much better understanding of the surroundings, for example, in this bird's eye view in Dead Nation. And third-person cameras are also often used to create this stylized cinematic visuals. So there are camera cuts and different angles to show the action. And one might also argue that being able to see the animations of your avatar is crucial for identifying with the avatar in some genres. So in that study, we contributed the kind of first systematic exploration of how interaction difficulty changes when we move the camera from this natural first person to this over the shoulder third person view. And we used the catching of flying objects as a task because it's not easy, it's non-trivial. It requires fast instinctive reactions. So if you are reaching for things, you can kind of iterate and, okay, now my hand is blocking that and now I move forward and there it is. But if it's flying, I can't really think about it. I just have to act. And we had found that in some experiments that it's difficult in 3PP. Here's an example of that. So I'm having this third person, so with a HMD and then a camera in the over-the-shoulder mode, directly connected there, and then trying to catch things, and it's just fumbling, just couldn't make it. So then we decided, hey, this needs more study. Why is it happening? And what's the relation when we start to move the camera? Is there some threshold or is it a smooth function or what? So here's our setup. This is actually a pretty couple of years old study that we just managed to get published finally. Rift DK1 and PlayStation moves for tracking and so on. 24 participants within subject study, meaning that each person experienced all camera views in random order. And then 7 total camera positions, 36 balls thrown in each with randomized target locations, flight time normalized to 1 second. And this is the main result. When you move the camera away from the first person view, it performance or catching percentage decreases almost linearly. Simple result. Of course, it has to taper off at some point because it can't go below zero, but anyway. And more interestingly, there's some adaptation happening, but only limited. So if we average all the catches over all users and all cameras, then as a function of the ball index, we see that during the first 10 balls or so, the players adapt, but then it stays constant. And the solid line is the average over all camera views. And the dashed line is the average over the last 2 each participant encountered. That means that the adaptation is happening all over again whenever you change the camera view. So it's not just adapting to our setup, but always to the camera. And this result is actually computed by neglecting the first 10 balls, so from the stable, kind of stable region. So how does this inform design? So we try to come up with these practical guidelines. And in a way, it's this. So this doesn't work. 3PP doesn't work. So it doesn't really help. But then when you think of the adaptation and so on, you can elaborate a bit. So of course, use this third person only when necessary if there are these fast tasks, similar to ball catching. And if you want to use third person camera, makes sense to have it as close to first person as possible because there's a linear slope. And I think this is important that since the adaptation is required whenever view is switched, probably best to switch only rarely. And instead of, for example, a dynamically moving camera, use something that stays at the constant distance. And then in the paper, we have more kind of then looking at different games like Sony PlayStation Move table tennis and so on, looking at what kind of game design techniques can we use to kind of mitigate the difficulties. For example, what kind of anticipated visuals can you use? It turns out that some games, even though I have not seen a postmortem about this problem, but they actually use this kind of predictive visual that there's a curve, okay, the ball will be flying there, then it's actually a reaching task and not an interception task. So you can, giving by increasing anticipation time, you can change the task from an interception to reaching. Okay, that was that case. I'm on time. Then I'll talk briefly about researchers' problem solving. So this is an area, surprisingly, I've been working with Jaakko, so we are solving computer graphics problems. My focus is more on animation. So there's a couple of SIGGRAPH papers, and the problem is that 3D animating is slow. So 3D animation is a process where the animator manipulates these degrees of freedoms with a mouse typically. And if you think of the human body, it's a huge amount of degrees of freedom. If you count the fingers, it's, I don't know how many. We usually operate on rigs with 30 degrees of freedom without the fingers or toes. And second problem is that if we want to enable natural bodily interaction with virtual characters, now that we have motion tracking kind of solved, then to have kind of similar abilities with the virtual characters, they need to have movement planning on par with human movement planning. And this hasn't really been the case. And okay, procedural animation techniques are getting more and more use in games, but many games and most games are still using pre-made animations, kind of a limited vocabulary, which works for like fighting. So there's slash or jump or something. But try taking hold of a virtual character's hand and then trying to improvise something, and they would have to kind of shovel their feet and avoid colliding with you and something like that, which basically try making bounden with the virtual character, and it can't be done unless we have proper AI for the movement. So that's what we have been developing, this SIGGRAPH 2014 piece. So this Luchador that figures ways to get up and evade danger. Not so naturally always, but still. Yeah. And then continuation of that. So now with more variety of poses. Of course, this stance, horse stance, is very stable, but now we can have some interaction with objects and even, for example, climbing over obstacles or performing circus tricks. This last one is not real time, but still. So there's no animation data, and the characters just have a cost function that says that, okay, cost is low when you are upright and you are on top of the ball, let's say. And then some sampling parameters, because it's a Monte Carlo search thing. And now I'm going to show live demo, because these are limited. So those things I showed were really CPU intensive, barely real time. And most importantly, they had no learning. So it's a kind of optimization thing where there's some memory, but very limited memory. And basically, for example, when the character walks, it's improvising each step at the time with no memory. So that means that it could go like this, change direction, for example. It's kind of drunken thing. So it's always reacting a bit late and figuring out, okay, let's place foot there and see what happens. So let's see if I get this going. There. So now we've been working on the learning problem for a while. And for example, deep learning is not the answer, at least just out of the box, because it tends to require a lot of data or long training time, like hours, to see whether it kind of learn to walk. And we'd like the characters to start walking and then learn immediately, so that if they take a single step, they can then figure out, okay, now I can repeat this with the other food and then keep going. So now, well, okay, it opened on the wrong window. So there it is. No, it isn't. God damn it. Okay. Technical issue again. I have to do that. I think that is placing the screen, like fixing the location on screen for some reason. And just a moment, display settings. Okay. Now we should have that. Okay, there it is. So now it's just balancing, but I can control it with the keyboard. And now it took a step. Okay, let's see, now it took another. And now it seems to have found a gate. And then let's move to the other backwards direction. That's a bit more difficult. So you see the trajectory, so it's kind of searching forward all the time. And the blue ones are the things that it's trying based on what it has learned so far. So I took a risk here. It can, in this backwards gate, it can sometimes learn a really weird gate. So it's not optimal in any sense. But so now I'm controlling it right. Let's go back again. Trying. Well, okay. But the forward walking seems to have converged somewhat. So now we can try switching it to a real-time mode. So this is taking something like 50 milliseconds. They're running on a single CPU core, not multi-threaded. So now it's in real-time mode, okay. Well, but actually so it remembers what it did and it doesn't use, now it uses, okay, let's see. Yeah, the backwards walking is not that a great example, but still the forward thing works. And this is very much work in progress, but I think this approach can now be extended to more complex characters. We'll see. But anyway, so learning happened within some 10 or 20 seconds instead of several hours, which is current state of the art, or at least several minutes. So that's about the problem solving. And now let's go to the final part. So research as exploration and discovery. So basically trying to predict the future by maybe creating it or parts of it, like Markus with the shadow cities and so on. But of course, we need something to guide the discovery. So I think here researchers need values or something to guide it. Can't just randomly doodle around. So for myself, I've kind of formulated a personal mission statement that I can refer to whenever I'm lost. And my mission is improving health through exercise games and digitally augmented sports that promote physical activity and movement skill learning. So I think I can't go wrong if I try to make the world a better place by improving health. In a way, we are also solving problems, but this time more of a societal than industry nature. One important such problem is exercise motivation. And finding motivation to exercise is super hard, especially at first when you're out of shape. And if you manage to keep going, maybe it becomes boring. And nowadays, many people seem to think that measuring, giving feedback is the key. However, motivation based on rewards, badges, and leaderboards is only the half of the picture, in my opinion, if even that. In fact, fitness trackers and quantification works for only a subset of people, and others might resort to cheating. If you give an incentive, people try to, or reward, people try to get the reward with any means possible. For example, by building a pedometer's cheating behavior.
It's a little too fast.
Some insurance bonuses if workers get good pedometer results, and that is a side effect of that. So instead of just these extrinsic motivations, rewards, badges, leaderboards, I think it's important to support so-called intrinsic motivations. Here is a list of intrinsic motivation components that have been identified in games and sports, both. And the essential research question is then how to support these with game elements such as story, aesthetics, mechanics, and technology. And in our case, we've worked a lot on competence or empowerment. For example, so you run faster while still being able to eat properly in the world, which was a difficult thing. Then, of course, you can jump higher. This is the reality. When it's defined, it's quite easy to do all kinds of things. And you can also have some dynamic slow motion while the person is in the air. And now we've been taking this further, so-called mixed reality empowerment, so using both physical and digital means. A real trampoline to give you some jump height and in-air ability, and then boosting that further on the screen. And then we also did some user studies to verify that you can actually learn trampolining skills in this boosted version while watching the screen. And of course, in real life, it's quite dangerous to add obstacles to the trampoline, but here we can use virtual obstacles. And later on, we've also worked on curiosity and social relatedness, for example, in the augmented climbing wall. I don't seem to have sound, but doesn't really matter. So augmented climbing wall is this installation, projector, Kinect to computer, some custom computer vision to track the player, basically turn a climbing wall into a touch screen, and then we can create all kinds of games there and diversify the movements and challenges in bouldering. And also in the curiosity, we can kind of support user-generated content in sports, which is a new thing. So, of course, climbers can't just go there and remove holes and add new ones, but when, for safety reasons, but when we have the digital layer on top of that, anyone can go and create their routes and be creative. And also then there's some social challenges that aren't possible on a regular climbing wall, like the climb ball game. So Societal impact of research only happens through large-scale commercial application of the research. People following in the AR games on the footsteps of Markus and others. Or in my case, I joined a company, virtual air guitar company, to commercialize things myself. Worked there 6 years after my PhD. Now in Aalto as a professor, my job is to educate and help other research-minded entrepreneurs. And it, as it happens, we've just launched a spin-off company of the Augmented Climbing World project. The company is led by Raine Kajastila, who was a postdoc in my group. And so far, it looks really good. So a week after the launch of the company, we had a viral video hit with the climb wall video. And that has brought in thousands of customers asking for quotes and also some crazy engagement numbers. So I think this is just mind-blowing. So that's the total likes, comments, and shares of that, basically that single video. And now it's generating engagement for other content as well. So to recap, I think in at least in Aalto, in my group, we do these three kinds of research: understanding and modeling players, research as problem solving, practical problems, then exploration and discovery motivated by societal problems. And the impacts are in form of design guidelines, better tools and technology to enable new games, and inventions that can fuel new businesses like augmented climbing wall. And as an important side effect, we are educating and empowering new entrepreneurs. And I'm also hiring, so if you're interested in doctoral studies, please let me know. And now we are about in the planned schedule, so we could now have a joint discussion and question session. So please, Markus and Jaakko, if you join me on the stage. And Miikka, you will be moderating, and
yes.
There's one, you have microphone.
We have microphones. Yeah.
Can you hear me? No? Okay.
Can you hear me?
Hello, hello. We can hear this gentleman. While we're testing, maybe I could already throw you the first question, but I guess like now that you've heard this kind of three different takes, are there straight away some thoughts like on your each other's presentations would be nice to hear.
So being someone who used to be in research and now I'm in the industry, I have a lot of friends who, of course, want to make collaboration projects with companies. And I would like to ask you two, have you actually been in collaboration projects between universities and companies where the companies have received concrete measurable value in short term? Because a startup where our runway is a couple of years, mm-hmm. It's always quite difficult. Because I think game research is very valuable, both tech and cultural research. But I sometimes have a little bit hard time saying our mobile game company has, I don't know, 2 years of money. Mm-hmm. Should we join this project?
Well, the two projects I described are actually both being commercially applied right now. In one by NVIDIA, which is, I think, a $30 billion USD NASDAQ company right now. And another by Remedy Entertainment. However, short answer is yes. There's other research that we've done in physically based rendering that's currently in tryouts at Weta Digital in New Zealand, which is the visual effects company that's the movies they make. But I should stress that all of this research has sort of come from asking fundamental questions like how little data do we actually need in order to capture a model? Mm. Or how little data do we need to come up with a realistic facial performance and so on. So these problems are motivated by ones in practice, but they're not directly aimed at solving a particular company's particular production pipeline issue, if that makes sense.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I think the remedy one is like the best example I can think of. It's kind of classic where kind of university has the latest cutting edge technological know-how, and Jaakko was acting as a consultant. Basically.
Well, we did this with NVIDIA. Mostly.
Yeah, yeah.
But they actually did come to us saying we. So actually, let me take some back. It was actually something that they approached us with. That, like, this is tedious. Can you help us do something about it? And then that's, you know, we just ran with it.
Yeah. So I guess it's easier to provide value when a company has a clear kind of that kind of question and project in mind.
But sometimes it's also important to, like these two other examples are such that, like, fundamental research questions have turned out to be practical, and that may require sort of a discontinuous jump in order to be exploited, but maybe there's enough value to be gained by doing that discontinuous jump that that once we've done the work and shown that it's feasible and, you know, shown that there is potential benefits, then it's sort of an easier sell, and it's hard to you know, propose people to do research that would necessarily lead to such discontinuities. I'm not sure if I'm
fair enough
making sense.
Is this on now? Can you hear me? Yes, better. Okay. Well, how about, like, I guess, Markus, you were saying that you felt a bit like you saw kind of a discontinuity between the research you did back in the day. Is it something like about what sort of research you're doing you think that might affect? Or like, those are, of course, tricky questions, but, like, would there be some advice or some direction or something you would do differently now after working already for quite a few years in the industry?
Well, looking at Perttu's presentation, I was thinking it might be the kind of design I do, not the kind of research I do, because when you do research and you try to build something entirely new, like a climbing wall game, then that kind of a design space is maybe more open to research-based innovation, whereas if you work in mobile games where everything is very genre-specific, very standardized, competition against other games is hideously hard. Because in mobile game space, you have to be very good mobile game. And then if you're also innovative in some fancy new research ways, then you can be super successful. But if you're only innovative in fancy new ways, it's incredibly hard to be super successful. So I guess, because you're breaking completely into a new area, I don't know if there are any climbing wall games out there. it's probably more relevant.
I mean, riffing on that, I think, I mean, this pretty much sums up the role of university research versus more applied research, is you can't afford, you know, huge risks when you're in production. And it's sort of the role of the research we do academically to sort of act as the high beams, kaukovalot, to maybe scout out obstacles or new opportunities for shortcuts and generally, you know, getting a view of the things that may be invisible to you when you're focused on, you know, keeping your eye on the ball and the everyday production.
And benefit is that even if we fail, at least it gets documented, usually, at least much more often than in the industry. Things are just buried.
As a designer, when I look game research papers, especially if they are video and mobile games, which should be relevant for me, we should discuss topics like whether positive feedback loops are nice in games that are this and this kind of games. One of the things that upsets me quite often is that game scores, often they try to make general statements about games. Mm. And in practice, in real life, that's very genre specific. The solutions you do in chess when designing a game like chess are quite different than the game solutions you use in Call of Duty. And it's all about context. Mm. And that's something that, like, if you do game design scholarship, make sure you know your context and your genre and focus your contributions in a very narrow area.
That's true.
It's a funny thought, thinking what would chess be like if it was invented today as a free-to-play?
It would have a tutorial.
Yeah.
I think that would be the first thing I'd add.
Mm. We will soon probably also get you people in, so you can already think of some questions, and we'll see how our fancy catch box is today soon. But before we give the mic to the audience, I would maybe still want to hear from, for example, Perttu and Jaakko, who also have been working for years in the industry before then coming to research here at Aalto now. So, what kind of things have you taken from there that maybe inform your research now?
I'd say practical things like just like software, how to engineer software, how to do version control. That stuff, when I was a researcher, I didn't have to worry. Then in the industry, we learned like quite rigorous practices of project management and so on. So I've tried to adapt some of that back, although we still don't have a continuous integration system, just haven't had time to get that up and running, but still. Because what we did right, I think one of our strengths at Virtual Aegitar Company was that we were creating really high-tech computer vision stuff, and we had the automatic testing. Whenever something was committed, an array of tests was automatically run, measuring the tracker quality. So we spotted a lot of bugs that way, that we saw a spike in some meter. Okay, there was something now in this commit and fixed that. And I fear that many of those are now slipping through the fingers. And yeah.
One thing that I'd say the most valuable takeaway is having worked on stuff that actually needs to work in practice to ship products does give you a sort of view on, it's a good calibrator for keep it simple, stupid. You know, it's when we work with out there ideas, I mean, it's valuable. It's part of the reason why we work in the universities, that we can afford to ask these questions that are free from the constraints of current production environments. However, I believe that in order to do reasonable research, it's a good idea to have some idea of what those current production environments are and what things are feasible in industrial applications and what are not. So when you sort of go away or go beyond what's feasible, you do it you basically know what you're doing. That I would say is the biggest takeaway.
Yeah, I second that. So learning much more critical mindset about what can you claim as a research contribution.
Okay, so would our audience have some questions? Hands up. Let's see if this works. Let's try it first.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
It works. I have kind of a concrete question in the sense that when it comes to research compared to inside a company kind of research where you have to go fast paced, what are the like, what would you take from each one of them to make, for example, what would you take from the industry to make research better and vice versa? Like, you know, practices, concrete things.
From the industry to make research better, one of the things is that actually, the people in the industry, they play a lot more games than people in the research. Mm-hmm. When I was a researcher, I was thinking I was playing a lot, but now I try to play at work at least an hour every day. So when I want to understand mobile free-to-play games, I just take the top list and I start from game number one, and then I work my way downwards until my fingers bleed. And it's a process that takes a year to understand a new genre that way, because then you're looking at very small details like, how does the monetization work? How does the inventory work? How does the store work? And I think it would be really nice or really valuable for scholars to play even much more. Like, it's very good. They are hobbyists and they are active players, but there is also this rigorous, like, I hate dating Justin Bieber, the game, but I played it, so now I know it.
Maybe pretty much rephrase what I said earlier is that having an idea of what practical limitations are is a great way to guide your thinking in, even if you're sort of thinking wild and out there in the academic setting. So that I think is the perfect combination. Having, you know, your feet in reality and then your head in the clouds, because then, you know, maybe you can see stuff that you can't if you're just, you know, shoveling very hard.
Mm.
That's ideal. You know, that's I'm there right now and I love it.
Yeah. So again, kind of rephrasing what I said. So the how to defining goals and measuring success better. I think that's something we should do as researchers better. I'm not saying that Aalto as a university should impose KPIs to everybody, but inside its small unit, people should have really ideas. What tells me if I'm now making progress in the correct way? And I think there's many PhD students that are kind of going more blindly than in industry. And we are not so, or at least, I should have more structure in working with my students and giving feedback
if they write Kai papers and SIGGRAPH papers, then they're doing great, right?
Yeah, but no.
So from the research, what would I take from research to the industry? Or as a game designer, it's a complicated question. I think research backgrounds helps me avoid some of the pitfalls that are typical in the industry. For instance, there's always the mindset in all companies, more or less, why don't we just copy the neighbor's game and improve it a little bit to make it better? Because that might be a sensible business case. And I think it's always a tempting trap because someone has done your job for you and the solution is there and you know how it will work when you put it in your game. But at the same time, more and more every year I learn that the Chinese are doing it so much faster and so much better. It's very hard to compete as a Western company by doing something that someone else has done. And I think research gives a good background, good kind of game literacy and a good ambition level and a little bit of integrity even that helps avoid that pitfall because it's always a danger.
One thing I want to still add is that, let's say you've gone through researcher training and got a PhD. Often when you solve technical challenges in your research, you need to master a wide array of sophisticated tools in algorithms and math and maybe experimental design and so forth. And I just feel that, you know, as long as you do hard stuff that's somehow connected to the work you do in the industry, it's just going to make you a better problem solver, even if there's no direct connection between the two worlds.
All right, any more questions at this point?
Okay.
Thank you. Well, concerning the augmented reality games you have worked on, both the experimental and the commercial ones, would you describe us some notable experiences, some interesting situations you have observed while the players were playing or as parts of the research?
Some interesting experiences of AR experiences observed. It's been a couple of years now. One of the things that was especially on the early devices, there was something that I didn't understand before I put the device on my head. And it's the way sunlight changes everything. Because especially, I don't know how they work these days, I never got the chance to test Google Glass. But one of the really weird things is that when the sun is shining, you can't see anything. And when the sun is not shining, it's sort of glaring at your eyes. And that's really something that you didn't anticipate. Back then, all those devices, they limited your vision somewhat, and that was surprisingly problematic. Also, I think you get a little bit of detached feeling from your environment, so you might be more prone to walking in walls even if you see them because you're just having stuff on your face. One of my favorites was we were working on a prototype. It was a mobile phone-based AR game, so
we were having this idea of let's make a Magic the Gathering kind of game. And then you have all these cards, and the cards have barcodes. And when you look at the barcode with your camera, you can see a monster, and then the monsters are fighting. And this was pretty nice until you actually try it. And then you figure out how narrow the angle of the camera is in the phone. And whenever you try to do anything except for staring at the card directly, you accidentally slip away from the barcode and you lose the monster. And that was like, this was supposed to work. This was supposed to be easy and fun and nice, and it totally wasn't. So that was interesting. Those are just some experiences.
All right, anything else at the moment? Okay, you can still think. I could throw in a question. How do you feel now from wherever you stand at the moment? Like, I think, at least in Finland, there's a certain, like, maybe skepticism in the game companies about, like, can you actually learn useful stuff, for example, at university or things like this. So, of course, here, as we are teaching game design, for example, to our students, what would you say, how do you feel about it? What are maybe the problems, and what could we do to make this better, or if, as there are also people from companies watching this, like, what would you say to them to kind of convince them that there is something to be learned also this way?
While you guys think, I would just to say that I don't think universities should be accountable to industries. I think the question is like the question is not important, although it's in practical everyday life in the society it is important. But I think we shouldn't be answering that. But
so, well, some of you know I teach computer graphics, technical aspects of computer graphics, and. Some of you in the audience have taken my classes. I have a policy of making the difficulty scale to basically infinite levels. Like if you manage to do this, then why don't you do that? And you know, basically all the way up until the state of the art in wherever that is in the world. And students appear to love it in general. And there are several of my graduates working in the core technology teams in high-tech graphics companies. For instance, I spot Daniel there, who works at the engine team at Remedy. One of their other engine programmers is my PhD student. I have people graduates from my classes working at Umbra, other places like this. And so my feeling is that as long as we teach stuff that's you know, as enticing and inspiring as possible, and as long as we're able to encourage and inspire students to work hard, then everything, all the rest basically just follows. Like, you put in the hours, and if you're excited, you put in the hours because it's fun, and then that's all we need to do, basically.
Mm. Yeah, I have kind of, there's two sides to it. So nowadays, more and more content courses are available online for free or for very modest payment. So in principle, if somebody is talented and motivated enough, they can learn all the stuff people learn in at the university by themselves. They don't need it. But but
you need to learn math and physics
but
and stuff like this.
Also about that, there's more and more really great like online linear algebra courses with interactive visualization and stuff. So the learning materials are not anymore only available at universities. But then I think it's really hard to stay motivated and stay guided in the right direction if you are not embedded in this community of talent here, and also like making these connections to for maybe help you land a job or found a company and so on. So I think there's still tremendous value in the whole kind of
absolutely
thing. Yeah,
especially if you want to be a game designer. Mm. you can take all the online courses you can, but you, like, it's still very hard to design a digital game, for instance, video game, yourself. So actually you need a project team to work with. And even though everyone in the industry says degrees don't matter, we only look at your skills, actually they don't look at your skills, they look at your last game. And if you don't have that last game, it's going to be really hard to get employed anywhere. Mm. So it's sort of a kind of a cycle that you have to break at some point. You have to have something to show and say, I did that. And getting there without being in an environment with other people who can make sounds for the things you do, who can make the animations for the thing you do, is very hard. So especially if you want to be a designer or producer, I think it's very hard to break in without.
Mm. Absolutely. And of course, having that community and experienced mentors is also, it's great for basically finding interesting things to do. Like, you don't necessarily know what's interesting out there unless you see somebody, you know, talk about it and maybe suggest to you that, okay, if you like that, then why don't you go to this direction?
Exactly.
And so forth.
And I think the threshold to the industry is sort of, I think it's sort of lowering because it's easier to get in these days. But at the same time, it's weirdly raising because there are more and more educational programs. So if you don't, like, if you only have skills and you don't even have a program, I just studied this stuff at home, it should be easier to get in because there are more positions, but it's sort of harder because there's always someone who said, at least I was in this and this school and I have this student project. So
yeah.
I want to mention one one more thing about industry collaboration, which is that for instance, in my graphics classes, I have corporate sponsors who give out small prizes for students who do well, and then NVIDIA gives out the big prize for the student who does the best in the class and so forth. And it's been super easy getting sponsors like this for token amounts of, you know, let's say you get a textbook if you got the most points in a certain assignment round or something like that. It's been very easy to get sponsors like this to the classes. And one thing that I was supposed to do it this fall, but didn't yet, is to engage game studios more in basically. I have interested parties that have promised to give out data and problems for students to do extra credit with. Okay, here's what you need to do in order to pass the class and even to get a 5, but then the extra credit stuff on top of, you know, maybe seriously provides some meshes for, you know, best fiends, the slugs, and then your mission is to animate them in a particular way, and, you know, you get points for it and you get to work with real data and things like that. So this is something, this is the area that I'm going to expand into next, or expand the collaboration.
Yeah, and I'd like to still add that also university education, master degree or doctoral degree, definitely helps if you are venturing to some, uncharted territory with your game, because it gives excellent information searching skills, analytical approach to, for example, let's say the virtual reality study was done as a master's thesis project. And so now that student, if they encounter some problems in virtual reality, he has all the skills to set up a user study, check whether whether this new design performs statistically significantly better than the previous, some where there was some problem and so on. So as long as you are not just copying what all everybody else did, then higher education definitely plays a role.
And then there are the social skills, the soft skills that everyone in a game team needs, especially if you're a lead or a producer or a designer. You need to be able to deal with situations where, like, a colleague comes up to you and has a really bad idea he wants to put in your game. And you have to make sure that he leaves this discussion motivated, he leaves this discussion trusting in you and having learned something, and that he will trust you with his next bad idea, because you never want to cut your team from brainstorming for you. And that is something that, like, you start to learn it in the industry, but it's very, very good if in the interview you can demonstrate actual skills. When someone asks, how do you deal with this situation? Can you tell about this kind of situation from your history? And you say, I've never made a game in a team. it's not a good thing.
Good point.
Okay, I think we are close to five. We might still have time for like one question. So anybody up for it? Yes. I feel lucky.
Good throw. Anyway, this is the basic question I keep asking all the time. So this is the Games Now lecture. So what games are you playing now?
I'm playing Puzzle and Dragons, a Japanese puzzle role-playing game. I've been playing it for 400 days with consecutive logins, so I've been playing it every day. I've spent 300 euros on it, well-spent money. It's an excellent game every game designer wannabe should play, including myself, because I keep learning from it every day. Puzzle and Dragons, it's an excellent game. Makes about $1 billion a year.
I've been lately mostly playing Pokemon Go, if that counts. Because, yeah, we have this practice, we go, well, my kids love it, so I play with them. And it's very interesting to observe how children and different aged children feel for the characters and what they take from the game to their daily play activity. So they role play the Pokemon all the time and so on. Before that, I should check my iPad. For some months, I've been really like now focused to some neural net stuff, and that's consumed all my free time, so not much play beyond that.
Well, how should I put this? I don't play games. I played a lot before I started making them for a living. I got so enthralled by rendering and light transport and technology that it just basically faded away. I've owned some consoles, but it's just really not a part of my daily life. I did play to level 8 in Pokemon Go just because it was an interesting thing, but then I just dropped it.
Yeah, I don't think it's that important if you're developing technology, but if you're a designer, then it's yeah.
I mean, I watch, you know, I know what they look like, I know what they do roughly inside and so forth, but it's really, I don't take pride in this answer, but it's just the way it is.
Then again, if you're a designer and you don't like playing, you still should play. So,
absolutely.
So for instance, in my exploration of top 100 games in the App Store, there are a lot of casino games. I haven't played all of them because they're quite similar, but actually taking something like the top best casino game at the moment and spending a week with it. It's quite a taxing challenge, but if you want to make free-to-play games, that's something you have to do at some point of your life. And it's better to do it before that important work interview. So what about you go all in App Store right now and get to the top casino game? Or maybe dating Kim, the Kim Kardashian game, what's it called? It was actually pretty good.
I think,
lots of humor, it was well written.
Good. I think that's a really nice closing statement for this. So,
thank you.
So thanks for this, gentlemen. Yeah. Thanks for coming. Happy we got all of you here with short notice. And the next Games Now lecture will be on the 5th of December, and we'll have a guest from the Wargaming company then talking about stuff. So stay tuned. Thanks for today, and those of you who are here physically, please come have a coffee with us again as usual, and bye-bye also to the stream watching people. See you later. Thank you.